the endangered snail darter. Some matters may begin political life at the micropolitical level and then escalate into macropolitical issues because of their symbolic, scandalous, or substantive characteristics. Consider the snail darter, a species of minnow, which was accorded protection under the Endangered Species Act of 1973. Its designation as endangered by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service was a routine instance of policy implementation. The designation of its critical habitats in April 1976 led to a major conflict with the Tennessee Valley Authority's Teleco Project, a multi-purpose water resource development project that was to provide economic development, hydroelectric, flood control, and recreation benefits. The conflict turned into litigation that went as high as the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court ruling that the ESA prohibited completion of the project led to amendments to the act that established an interagency panel to review projects for possible exemptions from the act's provisions. In January 1979, the panel ruled that the Teleco project should not be exempted because the project was ill-conceived and uneconomic. However, Tennessee congressmen were able to sneak through the provision that directed the TVA to complete the project, citing political problems and the difficulty of vetoing a bill that would fund numerous projects. President Carter signed the bill with regret in September 1979. The Endangered Species Act became the focus of macro-political struggle. This level of politics attracts most attention in studies of policymaking because it's quite often visible and as well as sharply conflictual and sometimes sensational. The macro-political arena, the conflict, is expanded in scope. Scott Snyder suggests expanding the conflict often changes the substance of the settlement, that is, the policy decision. Broad public interests are likely to receive police consideration at the macro-political level. A distinctive characteristic of macro-politics is presidential involvement. Whether the president more adequately represents national interests than does the Congress, and some contend in open to debate. The president enjoys the advantage in the macro-political arena because of the centrality and the visibility of his office, his capacity to formulate policy alternatives, and the resources he can draw upon the support of his proposal. The president can be the policy leader here if he so chooses. His actions will substantially affect the content and direction of public policies. As a comparison of the differing influences of Johnson's, Nixon, and Reagan's administrations on anti-poverty policy indicates. Moreover, the presidential interest attracts the attention and participation of others. In the chapter entitled Policy Formation, Problems, Agendas, and Formulation, we look at the definition of public problems, agenda settings, and the formulation of policy proposals, especially as they occur in the macro-political arena.